The Chinese have been in America for a long time. They've built its train tracks, fed its people, and served in its military.
We're just as American as everybody else.
They're so much a part of America that there are now more Chinese restaurants than there are McDonald's, Burger King's, and KFC's combined. But their experience in the United States has been one of exclusion. Once denied entry to this country, we continue to be underrepresented in media and politics. In this series, I'll take you to the oldest Chinatown in America, the fields of the Mississippi Delta, and the sprawling suburban San Gabriel Valley to tell the story of the Chinese diaspora in this country and how we've used food to fight exclusion and preserve our legacy.
My favorite dish is ginger onion crab.
Dim sum.
My favorite dish is a shrimp po' boy.
Yunnan crossing over bridge noodles.
红烧肉.
Taiwanese stinky tofu. Actually, I'm kidding. It's Cantonese dim sum.
For generations, our food has been a source of survival and resistance. To tell that story, we gotta start in San Francisco. Underneath the restaurants, trinkets, and fancy rooftops is a history of people who've come to Chinatown in hopes of a better life in America. San Francisco Chinatown is the oldest Chinatown in America. There are people here who are fourth and fifth generation Americans. Pretty crazy for me because I'm second generation, which means that my parents came here as immigrants. And there are Chinese people who have been here for more than 100 years.
They had the best roast pork, but now over across the street at Pork Chop House, they have the best roast pork.
This is Pam Tao Li, whose family has been here for over 100 years.
I'm fourth generation Chinese. Both my parents grew up here in Chinatown. Their whole lives, they were surrounded by exclusion.
Life was rough outside of Chinatown. Racism was deep, people didn't want the Chinese around, so this neighborhood became a safe haven for new immigrants.
My mom would describe it often as crossing beyond California Street, crossing beyond Kearney, was going outside of what was a safety and a familiarity. And so once you cross those invisible walls, you had to be on guard.
The Chinese have been facing discrimination since they first came to the United States.
The first large groups of Chinese men came because of the 1849 gold rush. And they came primarily from a very small area outside of the city of Canton in China.
That's Suey Lee. She's gonna help us navigate the decades of history here in Chinatown.
Chinese labor helped build the American West. They built the railroads. They worked in different factories. So they were a source of cheap labor.
Many white workers didn't welcome this. At one point in 1871, an angry white mob of 500 people went to LA's Chinatown and lynched at least 17 Chinese immigrants. Elsewhere, Chinese were attacked, sometimes even murdered, and Chinatowns were literally burned to the ground. Over time, this xenophobia led to the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882.
The Chinese Exclusion Act has the distinction of being the only U.S. law that specifically targets a racial group from coming to the U.S.
For the next 61 years, this law kept Chinese laborers from coming to the U.S. and prevented those who were already in the country from becoming citizens, voting, or owning property. Those who stayed in the U.S. had to find a way to survive.
During exclusion, it was very difficult for Chinese to work outside of the community. So if you couldn't find a job with somebody else, you would start your own business.
Like laundries or restaurants. That's how you ended up with dishes like chop suey. It's not actually something that was made in China. It was invented by immigrants here to have a dish that was both Americanized and Chinese, making both Chinese food and thus Chinese people a little less threatening to Americans. Remember how Sue said most of the earliest Chinese immigrants were from that tiny region just outside of Canton? Well, since the Exclusion Act stopped immigration, most of the people making food were from a place the size of Delaware. So what was known as Chinese food, like chop suey, was actually Americanized versions of food from just one part of China.
Once whoever invented chop suey started serving chop suey, then I think the expectation of diners was that you go to a Chinese restaurant, you're gonna get chop suey.
Chop suey and Chinese food really caught on with the American crowd. The number of Chinese restaurants doubled from 1910 to 1920, and Chinatown became a destination. When the great 1906 earthquake hit San Francisco, the Chinese neighborhood was left in ruins.
The area where Chinatown is located was totally burned to the ground. The city leaders at that time decided, aha, here is our opportunity to rid this area of the Chinese.
But the Chinese had a different idea. In order to preserve Chinatown, merchants rallied the community and influenced property owners to rebuild the old neighborhood to look like this. These buildings made Chinatown a tourist destination. From food to design, surviving in America was strategic.
From the beginning, Chinese would fight against the discrimination that was perpetrated against them.
The Exclusion Act ended in 1943, but for the next two decades, only 105 Chinese were allowed into the U.S. each year. Despite the network and resources that Chinatown offered, Pam's parents left when they could finally afford to.
Growing up in Chinatown for my dad was extremely harsh. So having the opportunity to move out was kind of a fulfillment of an American dream for him.
But for Pam, her dream was to protect and preserve Chinatown, including its single-room occupancy apartments, or SROs, housing meant for low-income residents.
My grandmother lived in those kinds of SROs. The cheapest rent would be, at that time, those closest to the toilet, because that was where the smell was really unbearable.
This is the one that was directly, the room was directly across the, from the toilets. I have a lot of memories about this place living in here.
And these very same SROs still serve Chinese immigrants today, like Ai and her family of four, who can only afford to live in a 10 by 6 room. So you can see that these SROs are really small, and it's a crazy contrast compared to the rest of San Francisco, where you have houses that are going for like $2,000 for a studio. Pam's dedication to protecting tenant rights in Chinatown started when she was in college in the 60s. Back then, as the financial district was expanding, the International Hotel, an SRO that housed elderly Filipino and Chinese residents, was set for demolition. Pam and others protested the eviction and were beaten by police. They lost the fight, but the I Hotel struggle became a symbol of unity for many Asian Americans.
It was a place that represented so much of who we were as a community, how we provided affordable housing for those who worked so hard for America, sacrificed their lives, left their families back home.
Today, as rents have skyrocketed, Chinatown is threatened again by change. What will happen to a community that offers everything from translation to legal services for new immigrants is unknown.
For the new immigrants, if there was no Chinatown, what would it be like if there was no Chinatown?
It's important to preserve a place like Chinatown. This is a space in where we can take action and move together to uplift each other's lives.